It's time for the No Nonsense Roundtable. Insights to capture your imagination from people you know and people you'd like to know about. Each week, a different guest from a different walk of life. Now, here is the host of the No Nonsense Roundtable, Dom Genova.
Well, good morning, everybody. It is the No Nonsense Roundtable. I'm Dom Genova, your host, here every Saturday, 10 to 11 on News Radio WHAM 1180. And if my intent is to have guests on that you don't know and you should know, and guests that you do know and you should know more about, it's a guest I have today is in the second category, because I have Mr. Jeff Tyzik, a conductor, arranger, composer. I have to tell you, you have an enormous resume, and it's delightful to have you here in my studio.
Oh, thanks. Good to be here. Well, if you live long enough, you better have a long resume.
Well, some people have resumes. Some people have good resumes. You have a good resume.
Well, you know, life is a journey, and you can look at it in a lot of different ways. But it is a journey of ups and downs, and successes and failures. But everything you do is the thing that contributes to your character and who you are as a person. And you know, looking back on it, it's all valuable.
Yeah, and what I like to talk about is some people who have pretty much of a straight journey in their life, and some people that had to pivot. So I take a look at like Jack Palvino. Jack Palvino went to school for to be an attorney, and he pivoted into being a disc jockey, and then owned all these radio stations, right? And who would have known at 10 years old that he would be there? But he pivoted someplace. You had a pretty straight line.
Well, It seems that way. Yeah, I did. I wanted to be a brain surgeon until I was in sixth grade and I saw a photograph of a brain and I decided that wasn't going to happen. But I came from a very troubled family. I had a lot of chaos in my dysfunctional family. And early on, when I started to get involved in music, music was a sanctuary for me. It was someplace I could go and express my emotions and really let my true feelings come out in a way that would allow me to sort of continue in life against the sort of tough circumstances that I grew up in. So it became, to me, kind of an event that kind of saved my life in a way. But also, early on, I had some really interesting experiences that really did change the way I thought about music. This all happened in my early years. When I was in sixth grade, I got to play a solo in front of the band. And I was, the best player in the band because I started a year before everybody else, and I really did practice and take care of myself. So anyway, I played this solo in front of the band. There was applause. And I didn't think, oh, I'm so great. I thought, wow, this makes people happy. That was the first thing. Music, it affects people. So that was an early thing. The second thing I learned was you can meet some really interesting people through music. Same year, we had an elementary school marching band. And that's very unusual. Usually their high schools have marching bands, but our teacher had gone to Michigan State and she was this big, rah, rah, we got to have a marching band. So we were going to march on Memorial Day. I lived in Hyde Park, New York, mm-hmm. which is north of Poughkeepsie, north of New York City. And she called me up the night before and said, Jeffrey? And I said, yes, Miss Holloway. She said, tomorrow morning, there's a service at the Roosevelt graveside. And they want a young trumpet player to play taps. Would you be willing to do it? And I said, oh, Miss Holloway, of course, So I go out on the street in the morning at like 8 o'clock, and I'm standing there with my little case, and I got my little uniform on. And a car stops, and an American Legion guy picks me up, drives over to the Roosevelt graveside. I walk back to the graveside, and there's a color guard, four military men with a chest full of medals, and Eleanor Roosevelt and her son John.
Oh, my.
And me.
Oh, my.
So, I was pretty nervous, to say the least, but I did my job. But there was the first example where I met, I knew who she was, but I really didn't know the breadth of who she was. I had to think about that, 10 years later. But I realized, okay, you meet some interesting people. So then in the ensuing years, when I was 12 years old, I started working at a car wash. And I'll never forget, I was making $1.05 an hour.
$1.05.
Yeah, plus tips. So, you know, at the end of the day, maybe I'd get $12, right? And I worked there weekends, but on, you know, during the summer, I worked there, you know, all the time. And it was a very diverse crew of 22 mm-hmm. people. So I learned a lot about other cultures and things there. But so I'm making, you know, this money. And I had a little band. My brother played drums. I played trumpet. And this guy played an accordion. And he came to us. He was older than us. And one day he said, "Hey, what are you doing next Friday night?" And I'm like, "I'm 13 years old. What am I doing?"
You're right.
He said, "Well, I got us a job." I said, "A job? Doing what?" He said, "Well, we're going to play in this bar for 2 hours. We're going to make $15 each, and we're going to get to have something to eat and drink." And I thought, you know what? You can make money at music. So those were actually three important things that kind of changed my vibe about what I wanted to do in life.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, Poughkeepsie, which was, you know, mm-hmm. 4 or 5 miles away from Hyde Park, had the biggest IBM plant mm-hmm. in the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when it came time for college, a really good friend of mine from high school, Chris Vidala was his name, he became one of the greatest saxophones ever. He passed away a couple of years ago. He was like a big brother to me. We always played in these bands together. And he was 3 years older than me. So he left town to go to a place called the Eastman School of Music. And he kept sending me letters about this guy, Chuck Mangione, who I knew. I had no idea who he was. And then he sent me a recording of Chuck Mangione to listen to, one of his really early recordings. So, you know, I came from modest means. Eastman was very expensive. Now, when I say expensive, this blows people's minds. Back then, this is 1969, if you went to a state school, you paid, I think it was like $500 a semester, or maybe it was $750 for the whole year in tuition. Mm-hmm. Eastman was $2,650. So, you know, my mom said to me, "Well, you know, maybe you should go work at IBM and just play music on the weekends." And I said, "No, I'm going to go to music school." And mm-hmm. she was like, "What's that?" You know?
Right.
So I'll never forget. I took a train in February, late February, to Rochester to audition at the Eastman School. And in Poughkeepsie, it was like spring. I didn't even have an overcoat.
Yeah.
And I got off the train in this blizzard. And I walked all the way over to the Eastman School, and I met Chris, you know, and I did my audition. And it was a pretty interesting experience. But I'll never forget standing in the main lobby of the school thinking, I belong here. That's mm-hmm. what I thought. But I also thought, there's no way I'm going to get into this school. So a couple months later, I'm at the car wash, and my mother pulls up, screeches to a halt, waving a letter to me, which she opened, by the way.
Uh-huh.
And it said, "You have a scholarship to the Eastman School of Music."
Oh, my.
And that's kind of how I got here.
So not only did you get in, but you got a scholarship.
Yeah, I got a 1/3 scholarship like everybody else. And by the way, with all the things going on in the economy and whatever, I paid all my loans back.
Oh, yeah, that's a good thing.
$50.55 a month for 10 years.
Yes.
I paid all the money back.
And so, you never forget it, because mine was $72.56 a month.
Yeah.
So, and with that, we are going into a break, and we're going to come right back. And I have some very interesting questions to ask you, Jeff.
Great.
We're about to be heading to a break. The music you'll hear today was recorded on July 16, 1978. An evening of magic, Chuck Mangione live at the Hollywood Bowl. And at that performance, Mr. Tyzik played lead trumpet in the orchestra. Enjoy. Anybody who's been to the RPO has seen Jeff conduct. One of the things we'll get into later is your arranging. The arranging process has got to be fascinating. But before we do that, let's talk more about your path. Now, we got you up into the Eastman School of Music on a scholarship. So let's continue that.
Yeah. So I came to school and as a freshman, all different programs I was in, but obviously I wanted to be in the jazz program. And Chuck Mangione at the time was teaching the jazz program. It was very small. He was the only person teaching in my freshman year, and I didn't get into the big band. I was in the junior band, with him. And he was a tough character. He took no mercy on people. Mm-hmm. Very tough in rehearsals, But I used to go watch him at night. He played at the Shakespeare, which is no longer exists, but mm-hmm. It was in the Xerox building. It was a little bar, and behind the bar itself, there was an elevated stage, and Chuck would play there four nights a week. So, I used to go listen to him play. And so I continued, working with him through my years at Eastman. And then he left because he got really big. Feel So Good came out and became like the number two hit in the country for 7 weeks. And this wasn't like number two R&B, number two this. It was the number two record in the United States. Mm-hmm. After I left Eastman, I started my master's and I taught 1 year. At Berger Junior High School.
High school?
Junior high school.
Junior high school.
That's a whole story unto itself. It would take a year to tell that one. Uh-huh. But then I went back to finish my master's, and then Chuck and I had lunch one day. He was in town, and I was talking to him, just kind of getting some advice. And he said, well, why don't you come work for me? And I'm like, what am I going to do? He says, well, I need help with my music library, and you can play trumpet on the dates where we use a bigger orchestra or whatever. So that's where I started with him. And then I ended up being involved in the production of five of his albums, and I worked with him for about 7 years. And so I it was funny, on the Music Hall of Fame night when we were both inducted at the same time, I remember making a little speech, and I said, well, I got my bachelor's and my master's from the Eastman School of Music, but I got my doctorate working with Chuck Mangione.
Yeah.
Because I really learned the music business in my whole time with him. And again, that whole saga in my life, that's about a 9-hour story, so we can't go too far into that. But I learned an amazing amount from him. I learned about the business. It was very, very intense. But rewarding, and as you look at it from afar,
So he was tough on you, but you saw that as an asset.
He was tough on everybody, And I will say this, and this is true. A lot of things in life, you learn from really good things, mm-hmm. but you also learn from bad or difficult things, And I had both with Chuck. We had these amazing things, and I would learn about the business from him, but, I also learned what not to do, mm-hmm. For me, he did what was right for him, but certain things that the way he ran things or did things, it was something that I wouldn't do. But you learn, what your own process is from watching and observing other people. And it's not just him. It would be same thing with Doc Severinsen. A lot of things Doc did that I thought were phenomenal. And then there were some other things I wouldn't do it the same way. So it's always important to really have your point of view about the people you work with and learn from their positives and negatives.
Well, it sounds like you're talking about the quality of discipline. Discipline doesn't mean being mean. It just means having a standard and adhering to it, right?
Yeah, that's true. But it goes way deeper than that, so we'll let that fly for now.
No, go ahead. Expand on that.
No, it's just, just kind of, how people deal with other people,
What's your style?
I'm a nurturer. I'm firm, I'm professional, but I'm a nurturer. I have kids, sometimes a number of years back, we had high school kids come and audition to perform with the Rochester Philharmonic. They walked in, I could see some of them shaking, because sometimes they go into an audition and the people who are auditioning them are very short, not very friendly. But the kids would walk in the room and I'd say, before we get started, tell me a little bit about yourself. Tell me what you're interested in. What are you interested in outside of music? So I would do whatever I could to sort of just calm them down, bring it to a human level, mm-hmm. and then go from there. Because I want them to perform their best. I don't want to put them in a situation where they're going to be emotionally troubled and then try to perform their best. Now, this goes to when I conduct orchestras. I mean, I do Rochester, but I also do Detroit. I do Dallas Symphony. I do Oregon Symphony. I was just in Cleveland with the Cleveland Orchestra, one of the best orchestras in the world. Mm-hmm. And when you stand in front of an orchestra, you're standing in front of 75 to 95 people who are all experts. They're all incredibly emotional musicians. What are you going to do with that? You know, everything is not going to go well for every moment. How do you negotiate these things in a way that comes out to a positive experience? It's like leading a team. It's like being a quarterback. It's you know, very similar to other disciplines, but it all comes down to how do you treat your fellow human being to elicit from them the most exciting and positive thing that you can get from their spirit.
Well, when I look at your career and looking at your Wikipedia page and trying to put this thing into silos, you have to be multi-talented because you're doing different things. You're creating, you're conducting, you're managing, which means you're managing people and people's futures, and then you're performing yourself too. And that's multi-talented. That's got to be tough.
Be careful what you ask for. You know, I always wanted to be able to do everything. Uh-huh. And, you know, and plus within all those skills within music, you know, well, there's a pop side of things and then there's the quote unquote classical side of things. And I have a foot in both worlds. And so I would do Philharmonic series concerts with the Rochester Philharmonic as well as the pop series. Just every other year I do maybe one concert. It's you walk in a lot of different worlds, and you just have to use all of your skills and every your experience in order to succeed in those areas. But at the same time, when you're dealing with the people, it just comes down to, again, your connection with humanity and how you get respect from people based on how you treat people. Mm-hmm. You know, it is, you get respect for your expertise and your knowledge and your command of the profession, but you get also respect on how you interact with people in difficult situations and in positive situations.
So what's the most fun thing you do?
Play golf.
I say I found cheaper ways of humiliating myself. Handicap are you?
Right now I'm a 24.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm just breaking into the 90s because I didn't play for 30 years and I hadn't ever taken lessons. So I just started like 9 years ago. And so now, just this past year, I'm starting to get into the 90s, you know, on a regular basis.
Okay. What's the most fun thing professionally that you do? Arranging?
No, it's all, you know, there's fun is kind of an interesting word. To me, I would say satisfying. You know, it's all satisfying. If I can come in and have a good rehearsal with the orchestra conducting, that's great. Last week, I premiered a new show of country music with the orchestra, mm-hmm. and we had musicians from Nashville come up. I had the real deal. This wasn't like, okay, we're going to hire a bunch of local players and pick some songs and some singers. No, this was like the real deal. The young players that go out with all the big stars came to town, and I arranged that music, and it was a different thing for me because it's a different style of music. And it was a glorious weekend, and the RPO, my fellow musicians, really went for this. I mean, especially the fiddlers who were playing all these fiddle lines. I mean, they were going crazy. So I had a deep sense of satisfaction after the last concert that here was something new and interesting that we could do together. So I'm always looking for new and interesting things to sort of pique my interest and stay excited.
Innovating. Well, we are about to head into another break, and we're going to talk more about this after the break. Well, welcome back. You're listening to the No Nonsense Roundtable here every Saturday, 10 to 11 on News Radio WHAM 1180. And thank you for listening. And I would like to remind everybody that all the past shows are available on nononsenseroundtable.com as YouTubes, or you can get them any place you get your iHeart podcasts. So we're here today with Mr. Jeff Tyzik, conductor, arranger, composer, and we're talking about performing on stage and his career up to this point. And let's do a little bit of shining a light on you. You have a you are the winner of a Grammy. Let's talk about that. That's really cool.
Well, I released my first album locally in 1979, and in order to get it distributed locally, I had to go to what was called the One Stop, which is a record distributor here in Rochester. And it was in the back of a record theater at the time. You know, the record theaters, there were about 18 of those in the Northeast, and they were as big as Tower record stores. And they were owned by this guy from Buffalo, Lenny Silver. And Lenny Silver also had a record company called Amherst Records. And he had Spyro Gyra on that, and a lot of other artists. And what he would do is he would sign people to his label, and then he would end up signing them to major labels if he was able to show enough sales in their product. So I had my first album with Lenny, and then we signed with Capitol Records. I had two albums on Capitol and two on Polydor. Well, during the same time period, I'm working with Doc Severinsen doing arrangements for his appearances with orchestras doing Pops concerts, and Lenny was a big band aficionado. He loved big bands, and I said, you know, Lenny, the Tonight Show band has never been recorded. It's one of the greatest bands in history. All we get to hear is 30 seconds going to commercial and 30 seconds coming back, but they've never been recorded. What do you think? He said, I would love to record the Tonight Show band. So we got in touch with Doc. We ended up in the next 6 years recording three albums with the band, and then a holiday album with the band and symphony orchestra and children's choir and singers. And then I did a studio album with Doc called Facets, which is actually one of my favorite albums. It's amazing. It's got orchestra. It's kind of like a jazz Pops concert because it's got a great band with phenomenal artists in it, but also it has an orchestra. So we recorded back, you know, to the beginning, we recorded this album, The Tonight Show Band, you know, featuring Doc Severinsen. And we had actually, Johnny agreed to let us take a picture of the band in studio, and he was in the photograph. So he was there just kind of doing his Johnny pose. So Lenny sold the hell out of that thing. I mean, it was really selling well, and then it got nominated for a Grammy. So I ended up going out to L.A., Lenny was there, Doc Severinsen was there, we were sitting there, and it was part of the pre-Grammys, because they were starting to, like, have some categories before the major show, but Doc's on one side, wringing his hands, Lenny's on the other side, sweating, and then they came to the category, and they announced that, you know, the Tonight Show Band with Doc Severinsen won the Grammy, and Doc went up on stage and made his speech, so it was exciting to do that. So my part in it, obviously, was producing the album, and Doc got the actual trophy, but I you know, the rest of us get a nice framed certificate that tells what we did. So, yeah, that was quite an interesting experience.
You know what people like to hear? They like to hear people's stories about famous people that they've met. You have to have a wealth.
I've worked with some really amazing people. A lot of people are from yesteryear, you know, great vocalists like Joe Williams, Tony Bennett, Pete Fountain, he's a phenomenal clarinet player from mainly the 60s and 70s from New Orleans. I work with Marilyn Horn, phenomenal opera singer who was one of the greatest opera singers in history. It just goes on and on. Even contemporary artists like Megan Hilty, I've worked with people like that. So I've in the course of my career, I've gotten to work with some pretty amazing people. I've conducted orchestras not only in North America, including almost all the orchestras in Canada, but also the Philharmonic de Monte Carlo. So I went to Monte Carlo and conducted the orchestra there. I conducted the Royal Scottish National Orchestra. I went to Kuala Lumpur and conducted the orchestra there. So right now on United, I have 2 million miles sitting in the bank on United Airlines. So, and that's, I'm not proud of it because I missed a lot by not being home. But yeah.
So our listeners are, quite frankly, they're older listeners. They're people that are over 35 and older, right? That's like half my age, right? But so we're not talking to younger people, but what would you give parents and grandparents advice about children that are interested in going to a musical career?
Well, I only have my own experience with my daughter, and she wanted to be an opera singer. And so I said to her one day, that's a really, you know, tiny discipline. It's very small circle there. And she said, I want to sing Carmen at the Met. That's my goal. And I said, that is a really specific goal. I said, you need to think wider. You want to perform. You need to sing all different kinds of music. You need to get a good education. So, but I encouraged her to follow her passion. Because mm-hmm. I think, you know, it's funny, I saw a thing where Warren Buffett made a comment, do what you love. And Mark Cuban came back 2 days later and said, do what you can do or something. Mm-hmm. You know, but I kind of believe more of the Warren Buffett thing, do what you love. So I encouraged Jamie to do what she loved. And she started to have a bit of a career. And then she got married and she had our grandkids and decided that singing wasn't going to work for her anymore. And then my manager left the business at the same time. So she became my manager. And now she manages 15 different people. She manages 25 different concerts that mm-hmm. I've created most of those. And she's one of the most successful manager agents in America right now.
Ah.
So, but the fact that she was once an artist and had a bad manager.
Right.
Has taught her how to be a good manager. So it was a circuitous path. She's in the same business, but she didn't end up singing at the Met, but she is managing people who do.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So there are a lot of paths. If you come to a brick wall, you got to hop over it or go around it.
Yes.
If a truck comes up and dumps 1,000 pounds of lemons in your driveway, you make lemonade. Yeah. You know, the only people who don't make it are the people who give up along the way.
Right.
You just have to keep looking for new opportunities. And I think if, you know, parents, yes, you have to be practical. You want your kids to make a living and be self-sufficient and have a good life. But if they're really passionate about something, you want them to pursue that as well. Music, you know, there are a lot of people who are in the Youth Philharmonic and they're thinking about maybe going into a career in music, but they also have a business sense. So maybe they'll go to the U of R, they'll take business classes, and they'll also study at Eastman. You got to find a balance and give your kids advice that do what is going to make you happy, but at the same time, you have to be self-sufficient.
I would tell my children, point yourself in a direction, not necessarily a destination. And we'll talk a little bit about that after we come back from this break, because I have a similar story with my daughter that is very analogous to this. Well, welcome back. You're listening to the No Nonsense Roundtable. We're talking today to Mr. Jeff Tyzik, best known as the conductor of the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra, but also arranger, composer, producer, and of course, musician. And we were talking during the break about what advice to give to young people as far as career path goes. And I was saying what I taught my children was to point themselves into a direction and not necessarily a destination, because career paths can be very varied. And the most important thing is to work in a field that you love. And I like to tell the story of my daughter, Alexandra, who graduated with a degree in photography from RIT. And the first thing you want to do is go out and start taking photos, of course. But Alexandra started by doing the work she could get, which was digital teching, which is assisting photographers. Now, fast forward years doing that. Now she's doing photo shoots herself, and she's had quite a few that have been published in the New York Times, a 2-page spread on September 4th. And taking photographs for the New York Times is probably a pretty good destination, but she had no guarantee of that when she graduated college.
Yeah, I think that's a brilliant phrase that I heard for the first time today, to go in a direction, not a destination. That really makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Coming from you, that's quite a compliment. Well, you know?
It's a great concept, for sure.
Because if you do love something, and that's what it really boils down to, if you do love something, being associated with it in any way is something that connects you. And talk about connecting. When I see you on stage and I see what you're doing, you're performing yourself, even when you're conducting, you're connecting the audience. And I think you have that ability of engaging people that may not be all that interested in music, being very interested in what you're doing. And it's quite a talent.
It's not planned. If I probably ever saw a video of me conducting, I would probably be embarrassed and not conduct anymore. You know, I don't plan any of that stuff. I'm just so connected with the orchestra and the music, and it just takes over. And I guess people appreciate my commitment to what's going on and maybe how I'm directing the music based on how I'm feeling. But where it's interesting, a conductor, you stand at a very interesting place because the energy from the orchestra is kind of passing through you. You're in that space between the orchestra and the audience, and the reaction of the audience and what you can feel is passing through you, coming back. So the energy just keeps flowing through the place that I'm standing, and you'd have to be made of concrete not to have that somehow affect you emotionally. Yeah. But I love the music, I love the orchestra, and I love trying to get the orchestra to give as much as they can possibly give, and not necessarily power or volume. Sometimes it's an emotion that is just romance or pathos or just beauty, whatever it is, to try to elicit that to the highest degree I can so that we in turn affect the audience. And that it goes with conducting, but it's also how you plan a concert, which pieces you perform in, not only what pieces, but what order are the pieces in, because each piece has a kind of an emotion. Some are exciting, some, as I said, are romantic or quiet or beautiful. What is the pacing of that concert? And you construct that in a way so that the listener goes on a journey. Mm. So it's all sort of related. It's not anything anybody really taught me sitting in a classroom. That's what I observed working with Chuck Mangione. That's what I observed working with Doc Severance. And on my, as you said, my direction, the direction that I went through, you learn by doing and being in those circumstances.
Well, I had one other person on the show quite a while ago, and I was talking to him about arranging, Scott Mayo. Uh-huh. And Scott said the challenge in arranging is that you want to affect your own view of the music, but you don't want to butcher it.
He's absolutely right. If I'm working on, say, I've done a lot of Duke Ellington music.
Right.
I've been commissioned to he didn't really write for orchestra, but I've commissioned to make his music work for orchestra. And Billy Strayhorn, they were two together. And when I'm working on that music, I feel like they're in the room with me saying, okay, this is a little too much Tyzik over here. Let's come back to what we intended. So I it's a spiritual experience, actually, when I'm doing it. Same thing I just did with this country concert. I'm familiar with it, but tearing that music apart and really learning what it was about, I was able to bring the majesty and the emotion of a full orchestra to that music without ruining it, but with supporting what the original intent was. So there's a fine line there, and Scott is absolutely correct in what he said.
Yeah. His contention is that you have to honor the person who actually produced the music.
Absolutely. And you can ruin the music by doing too much,
right,
but you can also ruin it by doing too little.
Yeah.
Because you can do very little to the music, and then it's kind of like, why is that sound there? It's not really adding anything. So there's a fine line about adding to what the meaning of the music is, but not overdoing it. Yeah.
Now, is that something that is that a talent that's just inherent in people, just like playing the saxophone or something? Is that, I mean, do you hear this in your mind as you're doing it, or?
I sit in a room and I really learn the song that I'm going to work on. For instance, two examples. The first song I worked on for the country show is called When You Say Nothing at All.
Uh-huh.
And the premise of the song is you say it best when you say nothing at all. And it's this kind of, it's not a mournful ballad, but it's a really sort of emotional thing about how I love you for who you are, and doesn't, you know, the words get in the way. Uh-huh. So that's a concept. Then I'm thinking, what instruments can I use in the construction of the arrangement to support that emotion? Uh-huh. So there is a thought there. I also did The Devil Went Down to Georgia, Charlie Daniels.
Yeah.
And one of the Nashville players said to me, well, who's going to play the fiddle part on this? I said, it's not a who. It's a they. There's going to be 32 Rochester Philharmonic string players playing these fiddle lines. So then I thought, anytime you hear this song, it's like a bar song.
Right.
People are going crazy.
Yeah.
I thought, this is a masterpiece. How can I make this a huge symphonic piece that lives up to what I think is the majesty of this piece?
Yeah.
So I took it that way, and I loved it because one of the Nashville guys said, this is unbelievable. I've never heard it this way in my entire life. A whole orchestra playing this.
Well, we were talking about fun before. I'm looking in your eyes. That you're having fun thinking about this.
I mean,
that's enjoyable to you. Yeah, that's, you're getting a little endorphin from thinking about how to arrange this in a certain way that nobody ever thought of before, right?
Absolutely. So it really comes down to one sentence with me. As I said early on, you know, I came from a really dysfunctional home. Where I wondered about, you know, history and future and whatever. And I would say the sentence is, life has exceeded my expectations.
That's wonderful. And we only have about another minute to go, but I mean, let's comment about the rich history of music in Rochester. I mean, all the people that were inducted into Rochester Music Hall of Fame, you are one, but you know, Chuck Mangione, Gene Cornish, who we have a relationship here with the Roundtable, Cab Calloway. Mm-hmm. I mean, all these people, I mean, Rochester people.
Absolutely. This is a city rich with art and artists and a legacy and a history. And as many places, the people who live here don't realize it.
Yeah.
Because they're living their everyday lives, and the people who say, "Oh, I'm going to go to Rochester as a destination," because well, there's wine country and the Eastman Theater, and they seek out the history of where we are. Not to mention, you know, Seneca and Harriet Tubman, and you know, the Underground Railroad, and all. I mean, Xerox from there, Bausch, and all these places. It's an amazing area, and I hope more people will just look into our own history.
Yeah, I think there are some wonderful organizations that have woven their way into the culture of Rochester, and certainly the RPO is one, and certainly if we're talking about an individual, you're an individual who has woven his way into the culture of Rochester. And thank you for coming on the show. It's been delightful talking to you, and I wish to have you back again someday if it's okay with you.
Love to do it. Thanks very much. I enjoyed being here.
Well, everybody, it's the No Nonsense Roundtable, 10 to 11 every Saturday on News Radio Wham 1180. Well, thanks for watching this YouTube. If you liked it, please like and share.